Yes, we have it fixed now. Thank you, gentlemen. Moving right along, our next speaker is Dr. Robert Biggs. Robert Biggs is Managing Director for Fixed Income Strategies Group at South State Duncan Williams. He is experienced in helping depositories and other institutional investors maximize their investment portfolio's performance regarding their AL position or organizational mandate. His responsibilities include overseeing a team of strategists and consultants that partner with clients to develop portfolio liquidity, revenue, and risk management strategies. He also leads the internal and external training and education facilities for South State Bank and Duncan Williams. Please welcome Robert Biggs.
Hello.
Ballard and I were talking a few moments ago. I don't know how many of you all remember this. It was a few years ago when right before the bottom fell out of the rate market, we had someone suggest invest in 10-year treasuries, and everybody went, oh, yeah. Well, you can address that sort of thing.
Yeah, we'll see how that goes. How do you follow up the 60% call for a recession and, third of banks going out of losing money next year? My dad always said people hate brutal honesty, not because it's brutal, but because it's honest. So we'll get started. We're talking about the investment portfolio, how AL, the ALCO committee, should perhaps approach it, what we can learn from the past two or three years. I think there's a lot of lessons, and I'm afraid a lot of people will learn the wrong ones. So we'll get started. Manage your liquidity. Every conference I've been to, every phone call I've had, that's the main focus. Last week, we hit 450 on the 10-year for the first time in 15 years or so. And the three calls I had that day were all on funding. How can we bring liabilities in? So everybody I talked to was not happy to see the rates go up, even though in the bond market, that's what we expect them to want to see. Well, how do we get here? Well, look at deposits and look at the M2 supply. If you go to the Federal Reserve and you download all the data and you run a correlation between M2 and commercial deposits, you'll find they're 99.7% correlated. Call that causation. It's pretty simple. More money's out there, more money's in the banks. Well, we've had the first material retracement essentially ever. For 30 years, we've had commercial deposit growth every single year. And now we're down 3%, 5%, and so our deposits are falling as well. And so when we look at this, I'll hold this, there are bankers who have never done deposit growth before. They've never had to do deposit gathering, and now they're having to do it. So let's talk about the investment portfolio. More importantly, let's talk about the investment policy. I've read hundreds of investment policies, and they all say the exact same thing. The purpose of our investment portfolio is safety and soundness principle, managing liquidity, support our AL position, and then generate excess returns. Every one I've read has said that, except some of them don't use the first one. They just throw that out. Safety of principle is a given. So managing liquidity. I'm a big fan of audience participation. When you got your bond account report, or when you're going to get it in the next couple days, who opens it up and say, this is what I had in mind when I said liquidity? Thank you. No one. There's no liquidity in the portfolio. There's none. Everything's at a loss, and because of the way we bought bonds, a lot of us don't have any cash flow coming back. And I call that a price volatility management approach. Past 30 years of consistent growth, we have done things a little bit differently. We used to focus heavily on cash flow. We still do. We have reports. We want this much in year one, this much in year two, this much in year three. If rates go up, we still need this much cash coming back. We do those reports. But a lot of people have switched over to what I call price volatility management. If I need to sell this bond and interest rates move, what's my gain loss? And so we project these out. And we focus less on cash, and we focus more on price volatility. What's my loss going to be? What's my gain going to be in a variety of interest rates? And so we'll do a real quick example what I mean by this. You need money in 12 months. You know you need it. You can buy a one-year bond at 1%, not reflective of the market, but one-year bond at 1%. It's going to have almost 3% price volatility, rates up 300 basis points. Or you can buy a longer maturity floater at 2%, maybe more if rates go up, and you'll have no price volatility. It floats. It's a real easy solution. You buy the floater. You get double the revenue when you sell the bond, and you sell the bond to, you know, meet the liability in 12 months. It doesn't always work that way. There's a bid-ask spread in bonds. We all know that. In this example, we're going to say the bid-ask spread is 1%. Just easy numbers. Still doesn't matter which one you buy. You could buy the one-year maturity and earn 1%, or you could earn 2% on the floater. Minus 1% will give you 1% return. They're the exact same. And that's how it's been for 30 years. But the problem we're facing now is to have zero price fall, it requires somebody who's willing to make a market on the bond. Now, when you go to get a bid, there's liquidity premium. You know, we used to talk about this a lot. You go through a lot of training. They talk about what spreads are. You've got credit spread, optionality. Liquidity premium was one of them. You know, we don't really focus on that as much anymore. In this example, you go to sell the floater. The trader on the other side has nowhere to go to it, so he's going to give you a discount bid. In this example, we're talking 3%. So all of a sudden, this bond, with no price fall, loses 4% of value when you sell it. You return 2%, you've been better off buying the one-year bullet. And I can promise it's true, because in this room, there's probably tens, if not hundreds of millions of dollars worth of floating rate securities in investment portfolios that are all at losses. If you go get a bid, there's no access to them. So I prefer a cash approach, because modeling versus execution, you know, actual results may vary. The only true reset is if that money comes back to the investor and they can choose what to do with the money. All right. We're going to take a second and we're going to talk about my favorite exit signs. The first one is exit 85 on Highway 40. It goes to a baseball park in Jackson, Tennessee. It is where my son hit his first home run. It was a walk-off home run in a regional championship game. That's not why it's my favorite. On the way there, he wanted to ride with his grandfather. 7:30 in the morning, they show up at Sonic for breakfast, and my 9-year-old son gets an extra large chili cheese coney and chili cheese tater tots for breakfast. 3 hours later, after the game, celebrate the home run. He gets the exact same order and a milkshake. So before 11 a.m., my son ate 2 extra large chili cheese conies, 2 chili cheese tots, and milkshake. The other one is in Australia. It's a gas station sign. It says, no stops for 1,000 kilometers, 625 miles. Basically, you better have gas. You better have extra gas. You better have a first aid kit. You better have a tire. You better have all these things, because if you get trapped out in the outback, there's a good chance you don't come back. And the question is, what do these have to do with bonds? And the answer is nothing. Nothing at all. Bonds don't come with exit signs. You don't know when you can exit the decision early. We need to know if we're owning a bond that's like driving through a heavy populated area where we know there's going to be an exit. We know we're going to stop and get gas. Or we know if the bond, there's no exit for it, that we're going to own it forever. And to do that, we need to look at the sectors that we buy, which ones we focus our attention on. If we're going to say liquidity is the number one thing in our investment portfolio, we should have an allocation to treasuries, agency bullets, and deliverable agency MBS. If we mean that liquidity is most important, we need to buy the 3 most liquid investments. And in a state like Kentucky with a state tax, if you're buying agency bullets, make it a Federal Home Loan Bank. Because Fannie and Freddie, for you, may actually have less yield than a treasury due to them not being state tax advantage. But we look at this. My bond accounting told me I had a gain. We did this exercise a lot this summer, even with a couple of you in the room. Hey, listen, I've got a gain on this bond. We sell it. I need liquidity. We go and get a bid. It's 3, 4, 5, 6 points off. And is because we weren't buying in this sector. We weren't buying liquid sectors. If you want your bond accounting to better reflect the actual market executable levels, buy in these three sectors. It makes a lot of sense. All right, so we're going to re-examine the investment policy. 20 and 21, everybody has their memories of it. Some people remember masks, work from home, more time with your kids. I remember low yields and liquidity. Every day for 18 months to 2 years, I had the same conversation three or four times. I've got all this money and nothing to do with it. It's earning zero. What can we do? And we did something. We bought. We bought long. A lot of us changed our investment policies. Some of them just went outside of it. I worked with an accountant in Pennsylvania. And one day in the middle of 21, we set up a meeting. I said, Larry, you're outside of your investment policy by a good bit. You're supposed to be inside of 5 years. You have a 7-year average life. I get that you are trying to generate some excess returns, but if rates go up, your portfolio gets longer and you're even more outside of investment policy. It's one thing to be outside of investment policy and be right. It's a whole other thing to be wrong. And he said, no. The ALCO committee, we talked about it. The board, we talked about it. Everyone's on board. He's no longer on board. They let him go. These decisions are made not in a vacuum. A lot of people have to have three people sign off on an investment purchase. The person who runs the investment portfolio is not doing this by himself. But I know that when y'all have your meetings, he probably sits in a corner right now because he's the one with all the losses and he's the one with no liquidity. So what do? We turn it on its head. We were promised that rates are going to stay low. As of March of 21, the dot plot showed the overnight rate being 62.5 basis points by the end of this year. They were close. Off going about 4.5%, 5%. So we didn't care about liquidity because we had all the money in the world. It was never going to go away. We didn't really care about the AL position. I'll show you an example of how we ignored that. We just cared about generating excess returns. That's what everyone who bought bonds, bought longs, who changed what they did, that's what they cared about, excess returns. And so the question is, are we learning the right lesson? Somebody yesterday, he made a great point. We don't guess interest rates, but we just model assumptions. I've got a good friend of mine who is a treasurer at a bank. When he got the job, he called me up and said, hey, where should our duration be? I was like, I have no idea. Like, let your AL report tell you. Don't ask me. It should be pretty clear. If your exposure is to falling rates, it should be long. If it's exposure is to rising rates, it should be short. And so let's look at what we've done. This is from our internal bond accounting system, our AL system, earnings at risk. From 2018, 19, 20, 21, and 22. 2018, interest rates were going up. Do y'all remember that? We're going to get 4 rate hikes in 2019. Everyone believed rates were going up. And so what did we do? We either didn't buy bonds or we stayed short. Right. Even though our earnings at risk, all the exposure was to rates going down. Did we protect ourselves? No. 2019, exact same story. Rates are actually falling down, falling every single week, and we just kept on buying short, staying in cash. I know an accountant who did a repositioning. They sold the bonds because we rallied on that day. Sorry about that. They sold the bonds because we rallied on that day and decided to wait on the reinvestment. By the time they reinvested, because every week they went to last week's levels, we were 150 basis points lower on yields. Trade didn't work out. But 2019. All our exposure is to falling rates. It's where our earnings are at risk. What do? Stay short. What happens in 20? A lot of cash, a lot of low rates, and our investment portfolio reprices, more assets go into it. And what do we start doing? We start buying longer. We can look at our earnings at risk. There was no exposure to falling rates. Why? Because our model doesn't do negative rates, and the 10-year treasury hit a low of 50 basis points. How much lower could it go? So we had this opportunity. Rates go up, we make a lot more money. 2021, exact same thing. We had some exposure if rates fall, but only because they actually came up some. That's all it was. But we had this massive amount of good fortune if rates went up. What do? We bought longer in 21. We bought even longer. So we weren't looking at our risks, but we're doing off market sentiment. Market sentiment is often wrong. Right now, where's our exposure? Earnings? Rates fall. That's what it says right here on our report. That may not reflect everybody's. The exposure is rates fall. And so we talked about, you know, buying a 10-year treasury. It's funny. I look at this as, why don't we reinstitute a barbell? Very consistent, normal. Most people who do barbells, they look at them, it's floating rate on the front and then longer duration on the back end. Right. Just from my floating rate example we just went through, I'd like to reimagine that with heavy, heavy cash flow up front. Because if we do that, we'll have liquidity, we'll protect our AL position. If rates go down, those longer bonds should be great. And then we'll generate excess returns. And so I look at it using what I call the core four, only because I'm not good at coming up with names, but U.S. Treasuries and agency bullets. I'm going to show you a cash flow example where we go through what this would look like. U.S. Treasuries and, in this room, Federal Home Loan Bank agency bullets. And we're going to build just a three-year ladder, nothing special about it whatsoever. Then we're going to go to short amortizing cash flows. 10 and 15-year agency mortgage-backed bonds. We call them just generic traditional bank bonds, nothing special. And then also, we'll look at a CMO, a sequential CMO at a discount. Sequential CMOs, they have a tendency to pay a little faster because of the way their cash flow is structured. So at a discount, your yield should improve. But we're going very short in these structures. And so we're going to add a 2 or 3-year treasury ladder, right, in a 10-year, a 15-year, and we're adding that short CMO. We're going to add tax-exempt and taxable municipals. Tax-exempts are generally the best-performing sector in a rising rate. These bonds have call protection, which means they have the ability to produce a gain if rates fall. They have the ability to protect revenue. You know, if you have a credit write-off, maybe we could sell some of those bonds at a gain to net those out. And then we're going to look at CMBS, agency-grade CMBS, notably Fannie Mae DUS, Fannie Mae ACES, Freddie Multi-PCs, and Freddie Ks. Agency-grade, safety of principal across the board. We're using a 10-year Fannie Mae DUS pull in this barbell. The reason I like these structures on the longer duration is they all come with some sort of call protection. Freddie K is usually defeasance, which means your cash flows are uninterrupted even if the borrower prepays. Fannie Mae has a yield maintenance provision, where if rates go down and the borrower is incentivized to refinance, he has to pay a penalty. Fannie Mae DUS is one of the only products where that penalty flows through to the investor. And so in a falling rate scenario, if that bond does prepay, generally take a nice little gain. And this is what we get, the final product. We're not talking about yields or anything like that, because I don't know when people are going to be back in the market. It may take a bit. But look at this. On the front end, our cash flow does not extend. Right? It doesn't extend. We get 27% in rates normal. It only drops to 24% of principal cash flow if rates go up 300 basis points. In year two, we've collected 45% of our revenue of our outstanding principal. Or it'd be 38% if rates went up 300 basis points. Now, once again, audience participation. If you were to put this together 2 years ago, who would not want 40% of their principal back? Perfect. Everybody would want it. Year three, over half the principal comes back. For half the principal in all those scenarios, one, two, and three. And so we have a portfolio that is giving us enough liquidity and enough cash to where we can lend, or we can not access wholesale funding, or we can, fingers crossed, bond broker, buy bonds. The other side of it, the part that protects us in a falling rate environment, is going to be those tax-exempt and taxable munis, that CMBS. Notice how that cash flow does not contract. Rates fall, we still have that structured scenario. And so I like this approach for most depositories, because it doesn't put you in the situation that we're in now. It's real easy to look at this market and what's happened, they close my eyes and say, all right, I'm no longer going to invest, or I'm only buying short because of how much pain I'm in right now. And that's the wrong lesson. The right lesson is that we create a portfolio that supports our revenue, supports our earnings, and it also safety of principal, liquidity, AO position, and generates excess returns. Thank you. I'm going to head over to the panel.
A wealth of data curated to improve your bank's performance where it's needed most. A one-stop comprehensive analysis of benchmarks that move the needle. Introducing the Bank Performance Report, a state-by-state quarterly publication that can transform the way you do business. In it, you'll find strategic profit planning, board reporting, measurement for performance incentives, competition analysis, and the most current trends in your specific market. So sign up today and find out how Bank Performance Reports can help your bank to grow.
Well, if we ever needed a lesson in why portfolio balance is so important, it was obviously SVB.
Yeah.
Now, we heard yesterday that what caused the ruin of the bank was the level of non-insured deposits, but what caused that to be an issue was the fall in financial stability in the portfolio, and that's what you deal with. Did they get bad advice, or were they not taking good advice?
Well, you know, Silicon Valley, I have a rep, sales rep, who works with us. He's actually decent friends with the portfolio manager who was at Silicon Valley. And so he texted him, you know, 2 weeks after everything happened. He said, hey, how can I work with you? What's your next spot? He was like, got to find me the job. So anybody want to hire Silicon Valley's old portfolio manager? All right. So, you know, we're talking about 2022 Forbes Bank of the Year. I think the article came out a month or two right before they collapsed.
Yeah.
The regulators.
Moral to the story, you do not want to be Forbes Bank of the Year.
Any attention is bad. No, they definitely got the advice. The regulators were on them. Now, they were the smartest people in the room. You can ask them. They came from Lehman Brothers. Two of the executives are actually at Lehman Brothers when it failed. So they're two for two. But that bank was in a unique situation. Deposits grew 40% on average. You know, everybody saw a big surplus in 20 and 21. You know, we did that M2 chart earlier. You know, everyone remembers the best stat ever, that in our 247-year history, a third of the dollars were printed in an 18-month window. They tripled. They tripled in size. And so they had two-thirds of their assets in the investment portfolio. And it reminds me of, you know, the movie Animal House, when they steal the pledge's car and it comes back and it's completely wrecked. And he said, you messed up. You trusted us. And that's kind of the day. They believed the Fed. Rates were never going up again. And so they went, they bought long. There was no credit component to it. It was all government guaranteed. There were some municipals in there, but that's still municipal government guaranteed. And they just bought long. And so if you look at it, their AL play, like, you can kind of see the math behind it. They're losing millions of dollars for every 25 basis point increase, and so they wanted to change their AL position. And I think that goes back to the investment portfolio being an AL joystick almost. You can change your entire AL position with just a few phone calls. And they did that, and little advice, if you're ever gonna take a $2 billion loss, make sure you do the capital campaign before you take the loss. Goldman Sachs made out great, worked well for them, but you know, within 4 hours, $40 billion, $80 billion walked out of that bank. The FDIC had to step in. But no, the regulators knew. They were being tagged with that a lot. And so you look at it and you think, well, this is so obvious. But they believed the Fed. They believed the little, they did a lot of bankers in this room did, is they just bought long. And the only problem is they had such a different concentration of depositors. You know, I worked for South State Bank. Right after they went under, right after Silicon Valley went under, you know, they put out something saying, hey, here's why we're different. You know, we have over 1 million depositors with an average balance of less than 20,000. They essentially had the exact opposite. They had 20,000 depositors, an average balance over 1 million.
Yeah.
And so when Peter Thiel the Founders Club already pulled their money out. It was just an old-fashioned bank run. You've got an SNL crisis lumped up with a bank run all at the same time.
Well, that was a great question, though, right? I mean, you're sitting there, a bunch of money market guys, and you go, why am I getting 1.5% when I can go over here and get 4.11% risk?
No risk.
And then the phone calls started, and that's when it all ended, right?
Yep. And we were, they're getting 25 basis points, or zero. They're getting zero overnight on $100 billion. Yep. That's a tight margin.
Well, can I make a statement? And then we'll get back to questioning Robert, because he's such a nice guy. But I want to make a statement to all the bankers. Don't ever forget Barney Frank. You remember Barney Frank?
Yeah.
Dodd-Frank, the bill we live under today. Don't ever forget that Barney Frank was a director on Signature Bank in New York when it went under. So keep that in the back of your mind forever, because they know nothing. Now, we're back to
That's funny. That was pretty good. Market sentiment can be wrong. One of my favorite stats or charts, I pull up Bloomberg, and I usually put it in every one of these presentations. But their Bloomberg graphs, what they call the speculative 10-year treasury, non-commercial treasury futures. Essentially, it is people who are speculating, do rates go up or rates go down?
Right? Yeah.
When we buy a bond, we buy an offsetting position, we buy a hedge. That's not in there, because this is commercial. That's commercial use. This is non-commercial use. The biggest one-sided bet that rates were going up, September 2018, early October, late September 2018. Rates peaked a month later, and it fell to 50 basis points over the next 2 years. It was the biggest one-sided bet until about 2 or 3 months ago. Now it's even bigger one-sided bet that rates are going to go up on the 10-year treasury. So the market can be wrong. Elliot Eisenberg is a great economist. I heard him speak a few months ago, and this is his quote, it's not mine, but he said, the Fed's the smartest people in the world. They know nothing. Because the market moves. I mean, even when you look at their dot plot and you look at their monetary guidance, they say this is our expectation given the current economic forecast. That's a fancy way of saying we're never wrong because we can change our mind. And the bankers, Silicon Valley, this example, were left to deal with it. First Republic's another example. They wanted, very wealthy clients, and they were making 30-year IO mortgages at sub-market rates to bring in these relationships with bank executives from other firms. And so there's a lot of people who bought into this lower for longer sentiment, just like there's a lot of people who are believing we're higher for longer right now. Not to say we're not going to be, because I firmly believe we're going to be higher longer than we maybe want, but the market sentiment can change.
Well, this morning we've heard predictions ranging from another 25 basis point increase in Fed funds rate to 175 basis point increase in Fed funds rate over the relatively near term. How do you manage a portfolio with that prospect hanging out there?
So that's a great question. You look at the investment portfolio, not only that, the curve's inverted. So it's not like you can go out 5 years and pick up more revenue. The curve's inverted. I look at it from right now, the way most bankers are managing their portfolio is they've actually got it on a locked drawer. They don't take broker phone calls. Is that the right approach? Probably not. The biggest fear for me is if you go back to the last five, six, seven, eight cycles, the portfolio yield was higher than the peak 10-year treasury. Right. So even in the bad case situations, usually had a gain or something there. Right now, if you had a 175 basis point rally tomorrow, recession happens, a CRE deal happens, something like that. If you have a huge rally tomorrow, most portfolios are still at a loss. And so, we say the word's great entry point. We've probably said it a lot over the past years and been wrong because it keeps going up. But at some point, you have to sprinkle in something just to get access from liquidity in other parts of your portfolio. If you have a bond that's a 10-point loss right now, if you bought a bond today, the market rallies 5 points worth, all of a sudden you have access to liquidity in both those bonds because you can pair off the losses. The other part is if rates do go down, if we do have some credit event, you can't access your portfolio to generate gains, to offset credit, to do any of those things. You know, one of the my favorite stories, it's a commercial bank, is sub 100 million. I had just gotten into the business, and we were on a phone call, and they were trying to figure out what they're going to do with two of the tellers. One of them there for 30 something years, been there longer than the person who was running the bank. It was a family bank, and we found a couple gains in the portfolio that kept them in business, kept her having a job. You know, that's not there this go around. And so if we ignore the portfolio completely, when rates fall, if you know, you'll have that issue. And so you can't just, you may take some short-term losses, but long-term, you know, whenever the curve's this inverted, generally it normalizes.
Makes me think of short terms, because short term, 6 month treasury is now what, 5%, I think? I mean, that's pretty attractive yield. Is that something to look at in terms of this volatile market right now?
I like a short treasury ladder. I use it in my example. I like a short treasury ladder a lot. Big revenue, big yields. We do a portfolio trends campaign, and got him Tom Fitzgerald. I think he spoke here last year. He puts it together, and so when we were going through it internally, he said, we have portfolio growth for the first time since early 2022. And I think every head turned around, was like, no, we don't. Like, we're not selling any bonds. The whole thing was in 6 month treasury since all everybody had bought. So it makes a lot of sense, but you could also look at it from a different standpoint. If you do think rates are going lower, if you think there's a recession, 60, 70% chance, would you rather have 5.5% for 6 months? Or would you rather have 4.5% for 10 years?
Yeah.
And so that's why I like that barbell approach.
That's why you have a job.
It does help.
Yeah.
I like the barbell approach because you do capture both ends of those things. We're not guessing which way interest rates are going, because your job is not to be profitable in a rising rate environment. It's not to be profitable in a falling rate environment. It's to be profitable. And so we don't guess interest rates. We try to develop a portfolio that supports your AL position.
Overall, my reading tells me that portfolio sizes on average in banks have been in a decline. Mm-hmm. What do you see in that trend?
Well, go back to 2019, 21% securities assets, that was the average. Go to 21, it's 26% of assets. Right now, call it 23 in that range. So we're normalizing back to 21%. I know most everybody in this room wishes it would normalize a little bit quicker, give you some of their principal back. So we're seeing that trend where, yes, people are letting their bonds roll off. They're happy for every bond that matures. If a CMBS bond prepays for some reason, they're generally happy about that. And they're largely, you know, keeping the portfolio in a locked desk drawer and ignoring it. I don't really think that trend changes until there's some confidence that the Fed is done moving. I think people will lag on making those changes. They want to be confident the Fed's done moving. They don't want to exasperate already the historically high losses. the end of this week, you're going to see probably the biggest losses ever for banks. AOCI will be probably an all-time negative, because even though, you know, over a year's passed and the bond portfolio should have gotten shorter, most cases it got longer because of the optionality in it. So you're going to see historically high losses, and I don't think anybody wants to be the first person to jump in with both feet and start buying bonds again. A guy who used to work with us, he became a treasurer at a bank in Alabama. Well, he was a bond salesman, very smart, brilliant man, and he was excited with yields being this high. I mean, he was excited. He talked the board into buying. He talked management into buying. He couldn't talk the regulator into buying. And so he's like, my hands are tied. I can't do anything. So I think you're going to have some easing of pressure from all these external sources before people will venture back out. Now, what I will tell you, if you buy on the last hike, the same day as like it, that's like, you buy the 10-year treasury, it historically has outperformed sitting in cash over a two-year window, sometimes by a lot. We've got a saying at the office, the Fed takes the stairs up and the elevator's down. Usually a 10-year outperformed that two-year from a revenue component and also from a gain loss if you look at it over a two-year horizon, judging from the last hike.
You were talking about during your presentation how banks changed their portfolio mm-hmm. investment practices during the pandemic. How has that trended? Is it changing?
Well, everybody that I know did something different. And I would tell you that perhaps those changes should be transitory. You've got 5-year buyers, agencies and CDs only. All of a sudden, they wanted to buy 10-year bonds. You know, completely threw their investment policy out the window, changed their entire practice. Now, if we say you're the best bond buyer ever, and you picked June of 20 to buy your 10-year treasury at 50 basis points, you know, 3 years roll by, that bond's at a 28% loss, 25% loss. If you were to buy the 5-year and stick with your stuff, that's a 2-year bond with an 8% loss. Well, we saw people who bought only 10 and 15-year mortgage backs, and all of a sudden they're buying 30-year jumbo twos, which are very, when rates go up, they pay very, very slowly, they return very little principal, and those bonds are 23% underwater, and they're going to be negative carry forever, it looks like. And so, you know, they would do those things where if they were stuck what they usually did, with the 14% loss, 9% loss, depending on the structure, now they're at 23, 24% losses. And so, I'm not saying these were bad ideas. In the presentation, I put 15-year taxable munis, tax-exempt munis, 10-year CMBS. I think those positions are right. But historically, I've never seen a situation where we start changing what levels of risk we're willing to accept because we are grasping for earnings and it work out in the long term. That generally doesn't happen. You set your investment policy to, I hate to say it, but control you, protect you from yourself. And so we went and changed them all. You know, one of my favorites is we have banks that will not buy corporates. No corporate debt whatsoever. And so I explained to them, like, we don't take credit risk. And I was like, I get that. That's fair. You take your credit risk in your loan portfolio. But they were issuing loans at 5.5% last summer when Goldman Sachs was borrowing at 5.5%. And I had to ask him, I was like, listen, I'm not saying buy corporates, but I'm saying if Goldman Sachs has to pay 5.5%, what makes Joe's Paint Shop a better, like, they don't have the same level of credit risk. And so I would actually encourage every portfolio manager and the lending officers to keep up with where corporate debentures trading, where's corporate debt trading, because you should at some level get a bump over what you're issuing home loan. You have to take care of your community. I'm not saying don't do that, but we do have to properly manage our credit risk.
So if you, while you're waiting for all these external forces to cure themselves, mm-hmm. what strategy do you expect all these guys to implement before year end?
So I think we're going to see a couple things happen before year end. Like I said earlier, the losses are so big in the portfolio that it cannot generate gains. It cannot protect you. I think you will see some people decide in the fourth quarter, especially if you stay over 4.5 on the 10-year, that they're going to put something to work. It probably won't be a lot, but I think you'll see some people put some things to work. The other side of it is banking was so homogenous for so long. I'm a tattle on myself. My work from home, my 10 to 20% reduction in workload, productivity. I almost stopped looking at your call reports for the calls because they were all the same. We've got too much cash, nothing to do with it. Now it's a little different. We talked yesterday about a beta lag. A lot of institutions, I think, are going to have very profitable years. Some are going to have very unprofitable years. But a lot of institutions will still have a lot of profit this year, and they see next year as an earnings trap. If they're well capitalized and if they have attractive earnings, I can see some institutions taking some of these losses. Probably in taxes at municipals, if you have them. But that is, I can see some taking these losses and either put it in cash at 5.5% because they think we're going to be, you know, overnight rates going to hold up to the next year, or maybe they actually go out and buy bonds with it just to have some sort of call protection direction. But it's not a blanket strategy because the industry is no longer the exact same everywhere. You're starting to see competitive advantages come out in different banks. These rural banks, especially, very, very helpful for them.
I suspect everybody in this room has a personal portfolio with some fixed income securities in it. Would you advise a personal investor any differently from your bank investor?
I'll tell you my investment. This is always fun working in finance. My family does this all the time. They say, what is it? So I put my money in an S&P 500 index fund. I don't change it. And I have a much longer investment horizon than my father does. That's what I tell him. If you are going to buy fixed income in your investment fund, you're seeing a resurgence in people interested in TIPS over the past 2-3 years. TIPS are, you know, inflation protected, they're treasuries. So you're seeing some of that. And so that's one option. If you want, I like taxable municipals. Usually you speak to retail investors, you say, let's buy tax exempt. The yields in tax-exempt municipals have become so compressed compared to taxables that a lot of structures, unless you're in that top 37% tax bracket, you're better off buying the taxable, the treasury over the municipal because of how compressed the yields are right now. So I do like taxable municipals. And if you're ever buying something fixed with a little bit of duration, call protection. The last thing you want to do is give up the option for them to call the bonds away from you. The other thing is CDs. Help your fellow bankers out. Some CDs. FDIC insured, you know, up to 250. You know all what's good about them. But that's a great one because it's one of the few opportunities. You know, the sector is one of the few opportunities where you actually have a chance to sell a brokered CD at a discount to the treasuries. It's the only sector I know that does this, but because it's such a supply and demand market, and some people are such, you know, locked-in buyers, you know, a lot of times you buy treasuries, I mean CDs at very attractive spreads to treasuries, and you hold on for 2 years, then all of a sudden you're selling them at spreads negative to treasuries. The market values them more than a treasury. Why it does that? Do not know. Just people who just buy the CDs every month. So I like that return for a individual investor.
Ballard. You mentioned tax-exempt municipals are one of the best performing assets in a rising rate environment. Why is that?
So let's just say you are in a 37% tax bracket. Right. If the U.S. Treasury or taxable instrument goes up 100 basis points, right, for you to have a similar tax equivalent yield, that municipal only has to go up 63 basis points. So in a rising rate environment, they lose less value because they don't generally move as much. A great example, we went like this earlier, that 10-year treasury that you buy at the worst possible day ever and you know, lost 24-25% of your value and it's still a 7-year bond. If you were to buy that municipal at the same time, the tax-exempt curve in the 7-year space is a 296, sub 3%. When it started off, is at 55 basis points. So it's only gone up 250 basis points. And so your loss is 14%, 15%. So it outperformed those taxable instruments. Right now, what I would say, if you were going to go out and buy bonds, buy municipals, focus on the taxable. Because the same reason the tax exempt outperforms in a rising rate, it underperforms in a falling rate. For the exact same reason. It doesn't take as much movement for it to make sense. And there's also, they trade at ratios. That's how we define how cheap they are or expensive compared to taxables. They're very expensive right now. So you would actually pick up more revenue and make a better AL play buying the taxable over the tax exempt.
So I'm just about out of time. Let me ask you about just closing thoughts. I mean, you've covered You've covered a canvas here. So if you wanted to pinpoint a thought to these, to this audience, what would it be?
So I think depository portfolio managers have the absolute hardest job of any fixed income portfolio managers. They will underperform insurance companies like that every time. Because when rates are low, we throw buckets of money at them and say, hey, let's go invest. And when rates are high, we say, you can't buy anything. So we have this constant, you know, buy high, sell low mentality when it comes to our fixed income portfolio. We built this out one time, and nobody gets into banking to buy bonds. I completely understand that. I think it would be very interesting if when rates were lower, we were more focused on loans and less focused on bonds, trying to get some floating rate assets, things like that, and then when rates are high, buying actual bonds, and see how that would play out. The other part of that, if you are the portfolio manager, I understand your pain you're going through. I know they're talking about you behind your back. I'm sorry. It will get better. You will be the hero again at some point. That's all I got.
I hope your friend at SVB finds a job.
I don't think it'll be in banking.
thank you for being with us this morning, Robert.